know more such amazing stories from Indian history, click the bell icon and subscribe to Live History India.
Hello and welcome to Tales and Trails. I'm Minnie Menon. You don't have to be rich to be passionate about art and antiques and turn collector. This week we travelled to Pune to trace the story of a doctor who went on a quest, a search across India. He came back to set up the Kelkar Museum. Take a look.
Pune, also known as the city of Peshwas, has a number of monuments and attractions hidden within it. The Shanivarwada, Pataleshwar Caves, the Parvati Temple and many others. One such gem is the Raja Dinkar Kelkar Museum. Tucked away in a narrow lane in Pune's Shukravarpet area, it is one of the finest museums in India, containing numerous historic treasures, the most famous of which is the Mastani Mahal, the residence of Mastani, the wife of Peshwa Bajirao I. The museum and its collection of 22,000 artifacts was a collection of a single man, Dr. Dinkar Kelkar. An optician by profession, Dr. Kelkar put together his incredible collection at a time when few Indians knew what an antique or a museum was. To know more about Dr. Dinkar Kelkar and his incredible collection, we spoke to his grandson, Sudhanwa Ranade, who is also the current director of the museum. Mr. Ranade shared with us the vignettes about his grandfather, stories behind the objects, and the challenges of running a museum in India today.
Late Dr. Dinkar Gangadhar Kelkar, who established this beautiful Raja Dinkar Kelkar Museum, was an optician by profession. And he also used to write poems on historical issues by pen name Ajnatvasi. Unknown, so he never wanted to know the people who is behind his own poems. That's the way he started collecting one by one somewhere around 1920. And during his times, the word museum, the word antique was hardly known to common people, perhaps some elite class. So in a way, late Dr. Kelkar was one of the pioneers of Indian museums. So he started that movement with one single object, which is a miniature painting. And from that point, he also never knew that he could create a museum kind of a situation. So somewhere around 1935-1940, his collection started getting some recognition. So his collection, in a way the museum, was first known as Raja Sangraha, and down the line it became Raja Kelkar Historical Collections. The entire collection was in his own house. You know, slowly he started getting some recognition, some support from industrialists like Shantanu Kirloskar, Bajaj family, Firodias, Agashes. So he started building, not really a museum, but a building wherein then he got shifted the entire collection. And there were a couple of turning points which occurred in his life. First was the visit of the former Chief Minister of Maharashtra, late Yashwantrao Chauhan. Then followed, this was in 1961, and somewhere around in 1975, the former Chief Minister, late Sri Vasantrao Naik, they paid the visits. And so he started getting some support from the state government of Maharashtra in the form of maintenance grant in aid. Plus, he has very good skills, you know, to negotiate, bargain and to convince. So a couple of industrialists also helped him in nurturing and developing and presenting his own collection.
1920s and 30s was a period that can be called a golden age of art and artifact collection in India. This was the time when great collections such as those of Sir Dorabji and Ratan Tata, now on display at the CSMVS Museum in Mumbai, and that of Nawab Salar Jung of Hyderabad were formed. What is even more incredible, unlike his wealthy contemporaries, Dr. Kelkar put together his collection with meager resources and great passion.
Although by profession he was an optician, but he used to travel across the country even by third class. His own financial position was not really allowing him to travel with some higher class. He went across the entire country, visited so many villages, and during that time people were hardly knowing the value, the price of these artifacts. So he could either bought those artifacts, or many good-hearted, kind-hearted people donated their artifacts, especially with those people who are ruling in part of countries. For them, this was becoming like an obstacle. But for Dr. Kelkar, it was a wonderful thing to go to their houses, convince them. If you like some object, he used to go and visit that particular person number of times, let him have to travel a lot. But finally he could gather together many things which talks about India's everyday art and crafts and even the lifestyle.
It is not just the history of these objects, but even the stories of how they were acquired by Dr. Kelkar that make them so fascinating. Take for instance how Dr. Kelkar rescued the Mastani Mahal, which was being demolished, and recreated it inside his museum.
This Mastani Mahal was built by Bajirao Peshwa first for his legendary beautiful wife Mastani between 1730 and 1734. This particular Mastani Mahal was standing on a piece of land in Kothrud near the Mrityunjayeshwar temple. And that particular piece of land, some industrialist wanted to buy to set up his own industry. So for him, that structure was like an obstacle. But for such a connoisseur of art like Dr. Kelkar, this was like an opportunity. So obstacle and opportunity stuck against each other. And the opportunist, Dr. Kelkar, for long good, could bring the entire Mastani Mahal piece by piece with the help of my grandmother, late Kamalabai Kelkar, my mother, Srimati Rekha Ranade, and one artist, carpenter, Janbat Sutar, you know, and all his team. And he created, rather rebuilt the Mastani Mahal as is in the present premises. For this kind of a work, he was rewarded by the Indian Institute of Architects by a special fellowship.
Another interesting story is how this 13th century Chola period statue of Lord Ram was discovered by Dr. Kelkar in Tamil Nadu.
The 13th century Chola period Lord Rama statue, that Dr. Kelkar got it from two different places at one instance. At one place he saw the head and at the other place the torso. So he took the measurement very intelligently, I would say. He asked the shopkeeper, "I am coming from such a far distance, could you get me a cup of tea at least?" And in the meanwhile he took the measurements and he realized at the other shop the remaining part is lying. So he negotiated independently with those two shopkeepers. And finally he got both the things here and assembled, and today that particular Lord Rama Chola Shaili from 13th century AD is one of the prestigious and precious objects that the museum has.
At a time when options for entertainment are limitless, museums such as these also face challenges keeping with the changing times.
I think running a museum in a typical socio-cultural and political scenario is very difficult, at least in India. Even I sometimes feel that doing good work is more difficult than doing anything bad. So running an institution like a museum has multiple challenges. It's like a multitasking. So if you ask me for my own job, you would wonder, my job starts from the washroom of the museum and tomorrow it may end with the Prime Minister of India. You never know. So there are financial challenges, then to take care of energy bills, expenditure on the employees of the museum, which grows exponentially. So you have to really look for how you can retain and increase your revenue all the time. So there are very limited sources of income for institution or museum like us. But fortunately, during last couple of years, we got some solid support from institutions like R.D. Tata Trust, then Jamnalal Bajaj Foundation, then Federal Foreign Office of the German government, then Bajaj Auto Limited, and the Infosys Foundation.
Despite all the challenges the museum faces, Mr. Ranade has ambitious plans. The museum is very keen to reach out to the wider community of not just Pune city residents, but also history enthusiasts around the world to help make it into a vibrant, intellectual, and cultural hub of the city.